Hi, folks, this is Larry Gatlin, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Real Life, Real Music Radio. Your host, Kyle Hutton.
Hi. How y'all are? Do y'all remember when this thing was turned around the other way? The first time I came back after they turned it around, I didn't know they had done that. And that's just not right to do that to someone.
Well, Larry?
Yeah?
I'm going to say that this is the first time that I've ever had a guest come out onto stage with their guitar still in the case. Is there actually one in there? I mean, are you going to play guitar for us tonight?
There is not one in here.
There's not?
No.
We've forgotten what that is around here.
Is that you, Willie? Well,
this
is a strange, strange beast. This is my new band, okay? See, COVID took its toll. Well, not that bad, but you just can't pay for them anymore, you know? They're not essential workers. What the hell? So I have a new band. Talk amongst yourselves.
Oh.
This is Johnny, and that's June. Do you love it?
Wow.
So you've never seen anything like it. So throw that thing somewhere.
You need anything in there?
No, I don't think I need anything.
All right.
Let's see, now we'll plug this. This goes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, June, this won't hurt. God forgive me.
Like I said on the radio, edited for rebroadcast.
Yes.
That's going to go on all night long. Okay, while he's getting situated there, here's what I want to tell you. Larry, first, thank you so much for taking time out of your schedule to come do this. And I know, you know, you did this with us within the first year of us doing this show, and I just told the people here, and I want to tell you, you saying yes and being willing to come down here, and it was your first time to ever play Do-Si-Do, was coming down and doing our show, and then since then,
okay,
you've played at Do-Si-Do a bunch of times.
Right.
But I just want to tell you thank you for taking a chance on this venue and our show and coming down here that first time, because it helped put us on the map.
Well, I'm honored. Songs mean a lot to me. Oh, did you see my T-shirt?
I got a new band.
Couldn't agree more.
Yeah, and I don't really know if I need this. Well, you know, we're going through a lot of crap, aren't we, kids? We're going through a lot of crap. Let's see if this thing.
You seeing that back there? All right.
Okay, I'm gonna tune it. I'm gonna take it out of the cue and tune it. Just a sec. Come on.
Now you will.
Am I turning it the right way?
You will be able to see Larry Gatlin tuning his guitar in the YouTube version of this because it's unedited. So tune in for that, folks. See what I just did there?
Well, when I brought it down from the heat up there. Plus, I'm not really very good at it. Come on, guitar. I've bragged on you.
Well, Larry, I'll remind you how this works since it's been 14 years since we've done this. I'm going to ask you a whole lot of questions tonight.
And if I don't know the answers, I'll just make some crap up.
Well, I remember last time. If you will, we all came here. I mean, I'm not saying you're not handsome or anything, but we came here to hear you sing some of the songs that you've written and recorded over the years. So before I start
now
asking too
it, right?
many questions, well, yep. You pick one and play it for us.
Pick one. Okay, let's see. Now are you getting it? Because I am.
You need anything else in there?
I'm really good. Does everybody have a piece of chewing gum? Do you have one, please? You know, I hope you don't think that's rude, But my mouth gets really dry because of the medication that I take. Yeah, and you want me on the meds, lady, okay? Don't shake your head. And you know where I got this? Thank you. You're very kind. Thank you. Bring this lady a beer on me or a call. Thank you. And see, so I chew gum. And like I say, I don't want you to think it's unprofessional or rude. It's really, Johnny Mathis told me about this. One of the greatest singers in the history of the world. He's a dear friend of mine, recorded a couple of my songs. And he chews gum when he sings. You know, I mean, he kind of hides it. Chances are, I just go ahead and chew it. I don't even try to hide it. But. Oh, that's so much better. Well, here's the deal. I was somewhere one night doing a little gig, and I don't know why I did this, but I just started up in the middle of something, and it kind of wound up. I made a lot of money in the key of G. The key of G's been good to me and my family. The old-time pickers in Nashville, they swear that G is the people's key. I made a lot of money in the key of G. Y'all are quick. I lost a lot of Grammys in the key of G. Don't any of y'all feel sorry for me. After all, none of y'all ever lost a Grammy.
Lord,
young lady who sang up here a while ago, she's probably going to get a chance to lose or win a Grammy someday, don't you? Is that young lady? Is that young lady? You're wonderful. You are marvelous. Wonderful. So losing them, I mean, winning them is better than losing them, but losing them is better than poking you out of the sharp stick. You know what I mean? So I've lost a lot of Grammys in the key of G. I made a lot of money in the key of G. And I wouldn't have made all that money if it hadn't been for SG. Brother Steve standing over there. And RG over there. And y'all. And big G. Songs like Houston. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Come on, y'all. Yeah, Houston. Houston means the last day of the tour and we're through. Yeah, honey, you and God in heaven above know I love what I do for a living, I really do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Let me tell you how I wrote this song. People always want to know how you write the song. And this is a songwriter show, right?
We're talking about song.
So here's what happened. Brother Steve, Brother Rudy, and I were singing at the Nebraska State Fair in Omaha. They do not call it the Nebraska State Fair. They call it Exarban. Exarban. That's Nebraska spelled backwards. You can't make this crap up, people. I'm telling you. So we did the shows, and then the brother, we were going to be in Cheyenne, Wyoming the next day. So the guys and the band got into two buses, and they went rolling. I had to do an interview the next day, so I did the interview, flew from Omaha to Denver, rented a car, and on the way up to Cheyenne, I thought, well, this is the first time that we've ever done the Cheyenne Rodeo, and it was very famous. So I said, I'm going to write them a song. So I started this little song. Cheyenne means I'm one day closer to you. Cheyenne means the last day of the tour and we're through. It was warm and fuzzy and touchy-feely. It was during that time, young lady. What is your name, sweetheart? I'm sorry. The young lady who sang?
Hadley Joe. Hadley Joe.
It was during a time when the songwriters in Nashville, we were trying to kind of get in touch with our inner Paul Simon, you know. Like a breeze. So it was Cheyenne means I'm one day closer to you. It was warm and fuzzy. So I got to the Cheyenne Frontier, to the Rodeogram. The brothers were on stage with the band doing sound check, and I went and I taught them the song. And after I taught him, my brother Steve, who normally doesn't say a lot, he's the quiet one, he looked at me and he said, Big brother, that really stinks. He said, tomorrow, We're going to Houston, Texas, and we're going to sing at the biggest rodeo on the face of the earth in our home state of Texas. And if you'll change that little "Cheyenne Mean Time when they come to you" and put it in a little 4/4 shuffle so some cowboys and cowgirls can get together and do a little two-step, you just might have something. I said, okay. And I changed it right on the spot from "Cheyenne Mean Time when they come to you." What did I change it to? Well, Houston, come on. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Yeah, Houston. Okay, sir, you're a big guy and I ain't gonna mess with you, but you're clapping on the wrong beat. I mean, it's. Look here. We're all God's kids. We're all God's kids, right? I'll get back to Houston and all that in a minute. I'll just get with you when I can.
This is your show, Larry.
All right, well, the Adderall just kicked in and things are working very well. My shirt, Songwriters Matter. I know we live in a precarious time. A great philosopher, Lord Andrew Fletcher of Saltoun, Scotland, back in the 18th century, he said something that I believe is very important. He said, "Were I able to write the ballads of a nation, were I able to write the songs of a nation, I would care not who wrote its laws." You and I can get together and write better laws than what they're writing up there right now. Don't you think? And you don't really look that bright, but because you ain't clapping on the right. Well, another old boy named George Frederick Root. George Frederick Root thought that songs were important, and 200 and some odd years ago, he wrote a song. Jesus loves the little children. Everybody. All the children of the world. Here's the most important part. Red, yellow, black, and white. They are precious in His sight. Jesus loves little children of the world, and so do I. Don't y'all? I know you do. Now, I could probably get in a lot of trouble for this, but I don't care. I'm in the Hall of Fame, and I make a good living. White people always clap on the wrong beat. That's just where it is. You need to get a little spirit in here with you. You can do it right. One more time. Well, Houston, come on. Houston, one day closer. You got it. It's killing you, but you're on the right. Yeah, Houston. Houston means the last day of the tour and we're through. Yeah, honey, you and God in heaven above. No, I love what I do for a living. I really. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Well, now singing at the world's biggest rodeo. Show up. Okay, y'all can lay out on this part. I'll nod my head when you come in again. In fact, you bring them back in when it's the right time, okay? Singing at the world's biggest rodeo. Show was a great time for me and the guys. But when I'm away from you, honey, time always never flies. Sleeping all alone in that holiday hotel show makes cowboy blue. But here I am in Houston and I'm one day closer to you. Bring them in, cowboy. Here we go. No. Okay, I'll help you. It's stomp, clap, stomp, clap, stomp. Houston. Just Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. You can lay out on this. Yeah, Houston. Do not let him clap. Houston means the last day of the tour and we're through. Yeah, honey, you and God in heaven above. No, I love what I do for a living. I really do. But Houston, Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. Well, here's what we did. We did the Houston, the Cheyenne Rodeo that night, and we did not sing that song. And we went to the Denver airport the next day and got in the plane. We got in the plane. We did. A lot of people say, "Well, I went and got on the plane." I'm like, really? On the plane's outside. How did that work out for you? It's words, Kyle. Pay attention to the world. It's a, you know, it's cold. And so we got in the plane, came to Houston, and at the old Astrodome, and we had the largest crowd ever to see a rodeo anywhere on the face of the earth. It had 48,962 people. It remained the record for 5 or 6 years till the folks at the Dome reconfigured it inside, you know, and added 5,000 more seats. And those scoundrels, the Oak Ridge boys, broke our record. But some of them are for Texas. It's all right. Houston means that I'm one day closer to you. That's the truth. You're a good sport. I made a lot of money on that song in the key of G. And let's see, I don't want to cry. This earth, this was a big hit, people. You can clap at the front of these songs. I don't want to cry. It's in G. This earth, this morning. But cry I will if you go through with leaving me alone. I don't want to cry this earth, this morning. So lay back down and love me and leave the leaving till later on. I was in Atlanta radio station at WPLO, I guess, and the disc jockey said something about my songs, and I had not written this, but he was talking about, anyway, he said something that I took not umbrage to, but I said, oh, don't say that. I said, you've hurt my feelings. I don't want to cry this early this morning, because it was about 6 o'clock. It was the early morning. And I said, I don't want to cry this early. So I said, I'll be right back. And I needed to go potty anyway. I had had a couple of varsity dogs for breakfast at the, that's another long story. You don't want to. And I was just in there in the restroom, not much going on, and I just said, I don't want to cry. I'm serious. Right there in that restroom, the echo, I don't want to cry this early. Wrote the whole first verse this morning. But cry I will if you go through with leaving me alone. Come on, y'all. I don't want to cry this early this morning. So lay back down and love me and leave the leaving till later on. Who's gonna do the high note, ladies? Anybody? I don't want to. Oh, I better do it. So that's another song I lost a Grammy for in the key of G. Would you like to say something? It's your show.
Are you kidding? Are you kidding? I'm not. No, okay, so let's go back to the rodeo for just a minute.
Okay.
When you guys sold it out, okay?
Yeah.
Because you don't know it, but that's the first night you and I ever met, except we didn't really meet. I was just one of the 49,632 people.
Oh, you were up there like in about the fourth row, right up there where the team comes out of the tunnel.
That's where I was. No, Larry, I don't know if you remember the first time you and I met, but I'll tell you this because it scared me to death.
Why?
We were playing. I was playing in Austin, Texas. We had a show at a old place called Hills Cafe.
Sure.
On a Saturday night, and then Sunday morning, we had the band in town, so we decided we'd get up and go down and play at one of the churches there in Austin, and we went in and got on stage and we played, and the preacher came over in between the songs that we played, and he said, Kyle, I got a question for you. Like, who are some of your influences? And I said, well, you know, Bob Wills, George Strait, you know, I kind of went down the list. And he said, no newer. And I said, well, you know, Radney Foster. And, you know, I went down some of the list of people, and he kept going, no, a little bit older. No, a little bit younger. No, a little bit younger. And finally he goes, well, what do you think about Larry Gatlin? And I said, well, Pastor, that's the first concert my dad ever took me to at the Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo was Larry Gatlin and his brothers. I said, and the only thing better than Larry Gatlin that night was Lonnie Anderson riding out on a white horse with her blonde hair blowing. And I think
that was a moment right there.
My heart skipped a beat. But then the pastor said to me, he said, well, say hello to Larry. And Larry, of course, was on the back row of the church. But Larry stood up on the back row of the church and waved. And I thought, oh, my God. Now what do I do? And then we got into the last number after the sermon. We just did a little honky-tonk version of Amazing Grace. And all of a sudden, I hear a familiar voice singing out of the microphone over to my right. And I look over, and Larry Gatlin singing Amazing Grace with us on stage. I about fell out on the floor. So, thanks for that performance at the rodeo.
Thanks for joining us
on stage in Austin, Texas.
Was I nice to you that day?
You were nice.
Good.
We were at church.
Well, you almost, you kind of are supposed to be nice at church. You know, we're all, speaking of this, songwriters matter. A couple guys, I've written a song, Sinners Matter. Right? Sinners matter. We all do things we shouldn't ought to do. Sinners matter. It don't matter. Even if the devil told you it was all right to do what you knew you shouldn't do. You know, so we wrote, but I'm a sinner saved by the grace of God. You know, and this, we're not going to turn it into church, but it is church. We got God's kids here and music. And speaking of Austin, I did not always handle this the right way. I was a kid, you know, and throwing money, when we were 23 and 24, throwing money at us, and I didn't always do it the right way. So I'm glad I was nice. And I ask people that when I meet people from my past and say, was I nice to you? And if they say yes, I say, well, I'm glad. And if they say, no, you really weren't, I say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I blew that one. I'm sorry. And I'll tell you why. Because you're speaking of Austin. I have a little grandson who's 2 years old, and his name is Royal McGuire Gatlin. First name is Royal. Now, and our Cougars. Coach Royal helped save my life, and Josh, our son, named one of his sons Royal. And Coach Darryl Royal told me something one time. He said, you can tell what kind of person someone is if you watch the way they treat people who can't do anything for them. You couldn't have done anything for me that day, right?
Right.
So I'm glad I was nice to you anyway.
Yeah.
There we go.
I appreciate that.
Sometimes I'm not. I'm just a human being.
Quick technical question real quick, because I'd hate to find this out later, but are we hearing thunder, or are we hearing wind through a microphone?
Thunder. Okay. Is it messing up your sound up there?
Because okay.
I'm just sound
making
as
sure
good
we're
as
not
I...
getting anything. Okay. So, Larry, let me ask you this, because, I grew up in South Houston, and you know, I grew up listening to all your records, and my parents were big fans, and I told you were my first concert I went to. So, being from Houston, you know, it was a big deal for my family that you were from Houston, and that you played ball in Houston, and that you... Well, you waited tables in some kind of little skirt at Steak and Ale or something like that.
It wasn't a skirt. It wasn't a skirt.
What was it?
Well, it was just a little. I would have felt more comfortable in the skirt. Little Lord Fauntleroy knee breeches with these knee socks and this flying nun shirt. I mean, it's good.
Well, legend has it that you would play some songs over at Steak and Ale, and at some point you finally got up the gumption to wind up on Dottie West's tour bus. I mean, you're going to have to tell us a little bit about that story, because I want to talk to you about some of your early songwriting.
All right. I mentioned Coach Royal. We were very dear friends, but long before I knew Coach Royal, I went to the University of Houston, and I'm very grateful for Coach Yeoman and the coaches there. Coach Melvin Robertson had been my high school coach, and I came to the University of Houston, and I met some great guys and some scoundrels, just like there are every place. And one of the great guys that I met, Coach Young, was always very nice to me, dear friends with all of his kids, was an old boy named Bum Phillips. All right. And he was one of the funniest human beings. And he treated us all equal, like dogs. No, I'm kidding. He always did it with a sense of humor. He's a great football coach. And I met his son, Wade Phillips,
okay,
who actually was my suite mate. You know, a suite, two guys here, and a you know, a little connecting bathroom. And we have remained good friends. And he's a two-time winner of the Super Bowl, and my dear friend, and he's here tonight. Where's Wade? Where's Wade? Right there. I love you, Wade Phillips. And Trisha Baldwin, her husband Bobby Baldwin was there. So my, and I met a young man who lived right down the hall from us named Mike Simpson, was played cornerback. Was he like from Pasadena or something? Poor Ness. And he could outrun my first airplane, speaking of airplanes. And
it was that.
It was that?
Yeah, through the microphone.
Okay, so now do I have to scoot over there to get air on me?
Yeah.
That would kind of defeat the purpose, wouldn't it, big guy? No, I'm kidding. So Mike Simpson was a great guitar player. He knew how to play that Chet Atkins thumb picking. And he helped me, was the first one who literally showed me the chords. I mean, he could really play. So I learned a few chords. After I got out, or Janice and I got married, and then I learned enough songs to start singing over at Steak and Ale on the Gulf Freeway there, you know, across from Bill McDavid Oldsmobile, you know, that Gulf, was that Gulf Gate? Out there, right, yeah, it goes out to Pasadena. Yeah, right there. So I did sing in the bar there for a little while, and then I was making about $20 a night, and the waiters were making 100. It didn't take me long to figure out that I was a better waiter than I was a guitar player, I guess. But I found out that some friends of mine, the Imperials, a great gospel group, needed a baritone singer. One of their guys was leaving. And so I called, and they said, well, we don't really need anybody right now. We're just going, ooh, oh, you ain't nothing but a hound dog. So they said, we might call you if we need. Well, they called me that night while I was at Steak and Ale. Said, come out. We want to give you a try. And here's a great thing. Here's a great thing. They said, can you fly? Janice and I did not have the money for me to fly to Las Vegas the next day. And the waiters at Steak and Ale took up an offering out of their tip money and sent me to Vegas. And I tell people I have failed my way all the way up to the top and right back down to the middle, and the middle's fine with me. Okay? I did not get that job that I had wanted so badly. But I met Dottie West. She said, and I wrote a couple, because she was singing with Jimmy Dean. The night the Imperials closed with Elvis at the Hilton, how many of y'all have seen the movie? The Elvis, it's great. It's incredible. So all that stuff, they were talking about the Imperials. That's the group that I was trying out for. They closed with Elvis on Wednesday night at the Hilton and went across the street to the Landmark and opened with Jimmy Dean. And Dottie was Jimmy's special guest. And all Dottie talked about was songwriters. Well, one of her favorites and one of mine, Mickey Newberry from Houston, Texas. Mm-hmm. She said, I wrote a song one night. It was awful. Like the boy who robbed the cookie jar, I ran away and hid. I don't know why, I just did. Oh, God. And she kind of felt sorry for me, I think. And she said, well, you're right, just writing that, aren't you? Just making it. I said, yes, ma'am. Because that's all she talked about was songwriter. She said, well, you look enough like Mickey Newberry. You got to be able to write a song. So everybody felt sorry for me because they know, you know, knew I hadn't gotten the job I thought I had. So she said, write me some songs and I'll send them to me. So Janice was teaching school at Pasadena at Stutchberry Elementary. And I came home after the gig with Jimmy Dean was over, went out to her class and recorded eight of my, you know, wrote some songs and put them on that little Wallensack reel-to-reel tape recorder and sent them to Dottie West, and she sent us a plane ticket. And the woman I'm married to 53 years yesterday.
Wow. Happy anniversary.
Thank you. Luckiest broad in Houston, Texas tonight. She said, we'll make it. She said, you'll never be happy if you don't try. We'll make it. So I'll teach school. We'll do it. And having that kind of support, boy, incredible. And she kisses really good. So
Okay, well, then let me do this. I want to fast forward just a little bit to...
Am I talking too much?
No, you're great. Is everybody okay?
Great.
Everybody good? Okay, so you get, you bring up an icon, an American icon, that they just made a new movie about. And if you haven't seen it yet, you need to go see it. It's Elvis Presley. And one of the most amazing things to me about your career, Larry, as a songwriter, is that you go to Nashville, you're writing songs, you're hanging out with Dottie West and Mickey Newberry and amazing songwriters. And the very first song you get recorded by another artist as a songwriter was a song called Help Me by Elvis Presley.
Well, that's close.
Where'd I miss?
Well, it wasn't the very first one.
It wasn't your first cut?
No, I had a few more. In fact, Dottie...
Don't believe what you read on the internet, folks.
No, oh, Lord, please. Well, if it's good... But that's,
I don't believe but it. That's but pretty
that's,
good.
But that's a great... And I'll tell you the... Because, you know, you do need to check out what you... what you hear... Here's what really happened. And I have not seen that version of it. When I got back, when we moved there, and Dottie recorded a song, and I was a janitor at WLAC-TV, and I had to set my my alarm clock for 6:30 in the morning to go be a janitor. They called it prop man. Prop men do not have brooms. And so I set that alarm clock. Come on, guitar, talk to me here. And the first time I ever heard one of my songs on the radio is when the alarm clock woke me up to go to my janitor job. And it was Dottie West singing one of my songs. So, but Elvis, his guys were old gospel singers. Here's what happened. Janice and I scraped up enough money finally, start having a few hits, some airplay. And we scraped up enough money to buy a little red brick house out in... is that on now? Out in Antioch, Tennessee. There we go. And it was $219.17 a month. And one night we were sitting there in our little house, in our little den, watching our little TV. And we got a call. And on the other end of the line was an old boy named J.D. Sumner. J.D. was with the Stamps Quartet, had started his own. That was one of the other groups. So the news that J.D. had for Janice and me was the fact that Elvis had recorded those songs, but it wasn't very far. So J.D. played the songs for us over the telephone. And after he played them, we thanked him and asked him to please thank Elvis and say hello. And then we hung up the phone and went back to watching our little TV in our little den in our little house. Then the next day, Janice and I went out and bought a big old house. And here's one of them. The child sing both of them. Oh, you wanted to help me, didn't you? Lord, it was the same session. Help me walk another mile, just one more mile. I'm tired of walking all alone. Lord, help me smile, another smile, just one more smile. I know I just can't make it on my own. I never thought I needed help before. I thought that I could do things all by myself. Take anymore. With a humble heart, on bended knees, I'm begging you please for help. That was not on that first little eight song, Ball and Sack, Reel to Reel. Wrote it a little bit later after I got there, but this one was one of those first eight. And Elvis recorded this. I told her to leave me alone. That's what she's done. Just what she's done. And a house built for two just ain't a home when it's lived in by one, one lonely one. And I can no longer hear footsteps from right down the hall. Here come the teardrops, bitter
just as a songwriter, I sit in awe of those cuts with Elvis Presley. That's just incredible.
Well, I don't know who Bill Gaither is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gaither's a whack job. I mean that in a good way. He really is a brilliant man and a dear friend. And I've forgotten the story I was going to tell. Oh, I called him one time, and I said, he said, how are you? And I said, well, I'm a greatly blessed, highly favored, imperfect, but forgiven child of God. He said, well, he's kind of the Mel Attilis of a gospel music. he said, we got to write that. I said, well, yeah, you're the gospel songwriter of the century. Why do you think I told you that? We wrote it, and he didn't like it. We wrote it. This is true. And I'll get back to the story I'm trying to tell in a minute. Remind me to tell you about a school in Odessa.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Now, so Gaither, we got together. We wrote the song, and it was good. It was good. And so we made... We made a little demo of it, and he called me about 2 weeks later. He said, I don't like it. I said, what's wrong with it? He said, I don't like the melody. I said, it's a great melody. I wrote it while you were in the bathroom. And it was greatly blessed and highly favored. And it was really pretty. I mean, that's pretty, isn't it? That ain't schlocky. Yeah, that ain't bad. He said, I want it to sound like All the Gold in California. I said, okie dokie. We don't have to ask anybody, so it's greatly blessed. and highly favored all the gold. All right. So that's what now I want to. Okay. I am greatly blessed. I'm going to get to go home. Thomas Wolfe, North Carolinian, wrote Look Homeward, Angel. He wrote one called Of Time and the River. But his most famous book is called You Can't Go Home Again. Well, yes, you can. I went home yesterday. Janice and I went home to Odessa. And those folks are going to let me, the nice folks have asked me to do a master class in songwriting, storytelling, poetry, just stories, words, you know. They're in my hometown, so you can go home again. I'm so jazzed about it. I've had trouble sleeping the last couple of nights because I want to pass along, to these young songwriters. And here's what I do. When I do a songwriter master class, and I've done them from UCLA, I've done them at the University of Texas, the Liverpool Institute for Performing Arts, that Sir Paul asked me to come and do. That's the music school he endowed that when he bought his old high school and donated it. So I did that. And I want to pass that along, and I do master classes. And when I do it, I say, so y'all all want to be songwriters, right? And they go, yeah, we do. I say, you are songwriters. You're just not song craftsmen, because there's only one of those in here, and that's me. So listen to Papa. And I mean, I know that's overkill and that's hyperbole, but just anybody can write a song, but the crafting of that. And that's why I'm so grateful. The first day Dottie brought me to town, we went to Hank Cochran's boat and with him, Hank and Jeannie Seeley, who he was married to at that time, and Red Lane, and we went across the lake to Mickey Newberry's boat. Those are the people I was thrown into the first night I was there. And they took me under their wing, and Willie and Roger used to, if Roger liked something I'd sing, he'd laugh. That meant he liked it. If he was real quiet and went like... And he'd tell me one time, he said, you wasted a great idea on an average song. Go fix it. Mm. Wow. Thank you. How much did he have to love me and care about me to say that? You know, so I'm going to do that lovingly. I really am. And I'm going to mess with them. And I'm going to find something positive to say about every one of their songs. And I did one in North Carolina one time. There's a big old black kid sitting back here behind me, and he didn't like me from the minute I walked in. And I went in and told him, I said, okay, so y'all want to be writers? I said, well, why aren't you writing? And I left. I said, write something, I'll be back. And I left for about 20 minutes and came back. And so I said, you, because I knew right off, it's an old white dude. What's he in here trying to tell me, you know? I said, what did you write? You want to do something? Well, come on, man, what'd you do? And he said, it was 7 o'clock and it was already 80 degrees. I said, no. No, he said, it was 7 a.m. and it was already 80 degrees. I said, no, let me help you a little bit. It was 7 a.m. and it was already 90 degrees. Now you got something. It's 7 a.m. and it's 80 degrees. That ain't no big deal, but it's 7 a.m. and it's already 90 degrees. Now tell your story, young man. And he talked about being a roofer. I've been a roofer. I don't want to, and I encouraged him. That's what they need. They need encouragement. So let me get back to Odessa, and I'll tell you this one story, and I'll shut up. Maybe. I probably won't. I've chewed a hole in this piece of gum. Let's get another one. What do you think, girl? Okay, good. In 1965, Odessa High School, senior English teacher, Miss Ann Louise Jones, gave an extra credit book report to me. I didn't need extra credit. I was her best student and her favorite. I'd already made A over A on my term paper. which proved beyond a shadow of a doubt that Christopher Marlowe wrote all of William Shakespeare's plays, since William Shakespeare never got more than 50 miles away from home and had no access to a library. So how in the hell did he do this? So I proved without doubt that Christopher Marlowe wrote every one of Shakespeare's plays and sonnets and poems. Made an A, over A. I also, the other thing, you could not make an A for Miss Anne Louise Jones unless you could recite, not read, recite from memory the first 26 lines of the prologue, Chaucer's prologue to the Canterbury Tales, in Old English. Wander the prelibid the shuri sota the drought of March at Paris to the rotten bother every vein in Switzerland. Believe it or not, friends from Pasadena, that is English. That's the English language. I know it's hard for y'all to believe. So, by the way, I'm oil field trash for you people from Pasadena. God bless oil field, huh? All right. So, that was in 1965. I made an A on the book report on Grapes of Wrath by John Steinbeck. That's 1965. 13 years later, in 1978, I was stuck in a traffic jam at the Hollywood Bowl on Highland, between Sunset, around Highland, over going in, over to the valley, over to Burbank, to have a meeting with Mo Austin at Warner Brothers Records about a record deal. So I went and had my meeting. I came up, I was stuck in the traffic jam, and right in front of me, while we're stuck, and remember, this is 1978, right in front of me was a 1958, a 20-year-old Mercury station wagon with Oklahoma license plates. And my internal dialogue, which I don't have any, it's all external, it all says, "Dear God, look at these Okies." I mean, there were kids hanging out the windows, or pots and pans, shit tied on top. Pardon me, stuff, edit, tied on top. No, it was shit tied on top, stuff tied, you know? And I said, "These poor Okies, they're coming out to California, they think they're gonna get rich and famous. And they're going to find out all too quickly that all the gold in California is in a bank in the middle of Beverly Hills in somebody else's name." All in one line. I took my little pen, wrote that on that Hertz rent-a-car slip. The light changed. Traffic broke up. I went over to my meeting with Mr. Austin. I sat after that meeting. It was 5:07 when I got back in the car. I knew I had to leave at 5:15 and get back around the mountain for another meeting. I had 8 minutes. By the clock, and I wrote All the Gold in California, the whole song, in 8 minutes. Wow. Went home, sang it for the brothers. We recorded it, released it. 6 months later, it was the number one country song in the world. Thank you. Thank you, God, for putting Miss Anne Louise Jones in my life, into my life. Into, not in, into my life. We have an English teacher back there. I don't know. I don't profess to understand how or why that happens. I don't know. But a great poet, William Blake, said, "If you who are organized," which means given organs, "if you're given heart," that's what it means, lungs, brain, a soul. "If you who are organized to communicate with God," and I'm going to mess it up, "if you don't do that, if you bury your talent in the sand and all you want is to be normal, sorrow and desperation will pursue you through life." It's what the good Lord said about, he gave 10 talents. If you bury it in the sand, get away from me. If you have some talent, if you have some ability, use that. Whether it's coaching football, you know, these people cooking back there, that's talent, that's ability, do that. So what I'm trying to do is take what that great spirit that I choose to call God, and I'm still going to call it God, and I don't care who likes it, don't call it God, and be grateful for that and try to pass it along. That's all this is about. Mm. So that's a long story, but what the hell, it was about me.
All right. Well, let's jump. We were just talking about 65. Let's jump 10 years to 75, when you had your first song that busted through the top 10 all the way to number 5, a little song called Broken Lady.
Well, it went to number 1 and won a Grammy. You've got to get your crap together over there.
Oh, man. Hey, this is your webpage.
Thank you and good night. Really?
Trust the source.
Well, yeah, no. Well, here's what happens. Back then, and we've had this issue come up before. First of all, you know, some of that stuff. Back then, if you had a number one record in either Record World, Cashbox, or Billboard, or R&R, there were five or six different magazines. If you had, in any one of them, that was considered a number one record. So it went number one in all of them except Billboard, and I think it really was number two. So whoever said it was number five, but I was anyway. I'm grateful for it. I was in Chicago. I was on my way home. I was in a cab on the way to the O'Hare Airport, and we had had two or three. God, I thought it was number one. It was five? Okay, he said it was five. She said it. I think God's a woman. Y'all are smarter than me. Y'all create everything.
Have y'all ever tried to herd cats before?
How about have you ever tried to herd gnats? So I was in the that cab going to the Chicago O'Hare Airport to come to Dallas. And I said, and we'd had two or three little records. You know, we had Sweet Becky Walker, she's not. We'd had that was like number 10 or whatever. I said, what do we do that is really unique? What can we, you know? I said, we sing harmony. You know, I love great guitar players and great players in that. I said, let's do, and out of my mouth in that cab came, she's a broken lady. Waiting to be mended like a potter would mend a broken veil. Broken lady, waiting to be mended and have hearts left of the pieces put back in place. And that's all I got. And I worked on the rest of it and it didn't come out. And somehow I got later that morning to Dallas and wrote the rest of it in the living room there at Finn Ewing, Ewing Buick, the real Ewings of Dallas, in their living room. And we recorded it and it did go to number one and won a Grammy, by the way, for Song of the Year. And it was the first one for which we were ever nominated. We won the first one and lost the next nine in a row. I voted for us every damn time. So go ahead.
Are you kidding? I'm not putting any more numbers to these songs. I'm not trusting any of this. But I do want to ask you, one of the songs that, first off, you released two songs in 1978 that really gave us a picture of what was on your mind at the time. One of them was called Nighttime Magic, and the other one was Do It Again Tonight.
Okay.
Nighttime Magic and Do It Again Tonight. So all I'm saying is we can just tell what you were thinking about a lot back in 1978. Nighttime Magic and Do It Again Tonight. But you have number one called I Just Wish You Were Someone I Love.
Okay, here's the deal. Here's the deal. God put all kind of urges and all kind of... Let me put it this way. And I've been married to this wonderful woman for 53 years, and this is overkill a little bit. I'll probably get overkilled for it. If you ain't thinking about it, your mind's wandering. Right, guys? Huh? That's just the way it is. If you ain't thinking about girls, your mind's wandering. So, what was this? Oh, nighttime. I was on my way to sound check at a gig at Lipscomb. I don't know why. They come out, and I was driving. I didn't have a guitar. It's nighttime magic. God, hold a hold on me. Night and day, I pray that you're prisoner of love, and I never want to be set free. And I got to sound check. And by the time I got to sound check, you know, from our house over to Belmont or wherever it was we were doing the con, I taught it to the guys at sound check that. And do it again tonight. I was in Denver and I woke up really early and it was cold. And I don't remember. How many lonely, Janice didn't even remember this song. I don't know if I do. How many lonely mornings have my feet hit the ground of some cold and lonely hotel room? Gotta catch a plane, catch a train, trying to be a star, so to hell with the pain of the early morning gloom. Gotta fight the fight, and Lord, what a fight. But how many lovely evenings have I lay in your arms where I'm safe and warm and you loved away the pain and made everything right. Home again, made everything right. Please won't you do it again tonight? That is a hell of a song right there. Yeah. I haven't sung the song on stage in 40 years.
I love it.
I'm serious. Now, let me let me do this. People, when I do my little master classes, and when people ask me how I write songs or where you get the ideas, I tell them, if you want to write, read. If you want to write, think. I mean, the next time you say, well, I think, write that down. That's valid. Well, I feel like, write that down. That's where. So, and the other thing is listen. And listen to yourself. Listen to cab drivers. Listen to short order cooks. Listen to everything. Listen to the wind blow. So I'll try to make this. No, I don't have to hurry up. I'm the star. So, that gum's good, girl. I try to pick up my guitar once a day. Somebody asked Hemingway, Ernest Hemingway, how do you write? He said, I sit down at my typewriter and bleed. He said, I try to write one true sentence a day. Okay, that was his method. If I try to, if I do, fine. If I don't, if I won't go play golf, I do not make myself do it. I do not. That's not how I do it. So one night I was sitting down, and I'll have to kind of, I was sitting down in the basement of our first little house, in Antioch, Tennessee, that $219.50. And I'm no great shakes as a guitar player. I'll be the first one to admit that. But I had my little gut string and I went. What chord? Well, it's D, up 4 frets. I'd never played that chord in my life. I said, that is beautiful, Larry. You've got to write. That is a gorgeous melody, and I've worked on it. And it was blah 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 blah. It was awful. It was just drivel. It was horrible. So I worked on it for an hour. Nothing. It was I love you, you love me. Oh, how happy we can be. Doo da doo da. It was horrible. It was horrible. So I put the guitar. I put it down, and I walked up the stairs from the basement. I was walking across the floor, the kitchen floor, to go get in bed with Janice, and I was walking across there, and I said out loud, because I have no internal dialogue, I said, what am I going to do now? I've got that beautiful melody and I don't have, what am I going to do now? What will I do? What will we do? I walked back across the kitchen, walked down the stairs, and went, what will we do now? You've broken the code. What will we do now? You tell me. The hourglass is all out of sight. How could love slip through our fingers and leave nothing but time on our hands? And how will we live now? You tell me. With parts of our hearts torn away, and then out of the clear blue sky, just existing makes dying look easy. just exist. Just existing makes dying look easy. But maybe tomorrow I've done enough dying. Today I went, ooh, ooh, that is good. Write a second verse, Larry. Blah, 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 blah. It was worse than the first bunch of drivel. It was horrible. I gave up. I put the guitar down. I walked up the stairs. I walked across the kitchen to go get in bed with my beautiful wife, Janice. And I said to myself, how am I going to go to sleep now? How will I sleep now? I've got the first verse. That's going to go through my head all night. How will I sleep? I can't. I turned around, walked back across the kitchen, walked down the stairs, picked it. How will I sleep now? You tell me. With only my arm by my side, perhaps I'll learn sleeping all over, and just maybe without dreaming this time. And who will make you laugh now? You tell me. Since you've sent your clown on his way. Again, I don't think I'll cry, just die laughing. But maybe tomorrow I've done enough dying today. It's my favorite song I've ever written. If they said, sing one, kid, I'd call Steve and Rudy to come sing the harmony parts, and Steve Smith to play the guitar, and that's the one I'd sing right there.
Yeah. Yeah. Did we play Broken Lady?
No. We didn't.
We didn't. We somehow went from me asking about that song all the way
deal
around
with
and
it.
We missed it.
Deal
so play,
with
play
it.
Broken
well,
Lady.
Well, deal with it. If we go around it a little bit, just deal with it. We didn't do Broken Lady?
We didn't.
Well, I did the first verse. Okay. Anyway, I did the part that I wrote in the cab, right? She's a bro. Okay, it starts out with Gatlin Brothers Harmony, right? And here's how we do it on stage. We'll go. Two. She's a broken lady. Okay, just a second. Here's what I want to do. We have any Church of Christ people here tonight? Okay, this is the a cappella part. Y'all can sing along, okay? And you ain't going to hell for singing in church. And I just got to pick on everybody. One, two, three. She's a broken lady. Thank you. Waiting to be mended. Like a potter would mend a broken vase. Hit me, band.
Where's the
a broken lady wait to be mended and have once left other pieces put back in place. Good. Her love's like a fortress round a man she would have died for, taking care to take care of all he needed. But the lady's fortress slowly turned into a prison, and the warning signs he gave she never heeded. She vowed every morning that what God joined together, no one else in the world could put apart. Then the walls came tumbling to the ground, her world came crashing down. like a potter with men, a broken vein, a broken lady, waiting to be mended, and half hearts left, other pieces put back in place. And have what's left of the pieces put back in place.
Yeah. Yeah. Is everybody having a good time tonight? Is everybody doing okay? Yeah. All right. I need y'all to help us out for a minute. We start each episode of the radio show with a liner. So, Larry, I'm going to need your help. If you'll say, this is Larry Gatlin, and this is Real Life, Real Music, then you guys are just going to go nuts, okay? For about 4 minutes, and then I'll catch you up. No, I'm just kidding. I'll give you this when it's time.
Good evening, and welcome to Disney World. No, that's not right.
This is Larry Gatlin, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Three. Hi, folks. It's Larry Gatlin, and this is Real Life, Real Music.
Perfect. Man, that was great. That was great. Okay. So, Larry.
Yep.
I want to ask you about a question. A song that I think you wrote. I'm just kidding. I know you wrote it, but I'm not going to say the number because it's probably wrong. But I want to hear the story behind the song "Statues Without Hearts."
When I met Janice, like I said, yesterday was 53 years. She is the most incredible human I've ever known. When we stood up there together 53 years ago, love, honor, cherish, that obey part, she's a little shaky on that sometimes. For better, for worse, richer, for poorer. I tell people she's either made out of Teflon or Kevlar or asbestos or something. because, like I say, I wasn't always living at the foot of the cross, exactly. There's an old saying, they're called the Ten Commandments, not the Ten Suggestions. Okay? Love, honor, cherish, better, worse, sickness, health. She meant that when she took those. And I did too. And so I put her through stuff. We put each other. She screws up every now and then. A little bit. She won't admit it. But the way we have made this, like I say, is the grace of God and loving each other. And we, back when we still lived here in Houston, over on the Gulf Freeway, we got in an argument about something, and I was probably wrong. You know, that'll say, if a tree falls in the forest and there's no one there to hear it, is the husband still wrong? And we had an argument, and we came to an agreement that night. We worked it out. We just worked it out. We made a vow to each other that we would never go to sleep mad at each other. We'd fix it. We would work it out. We would get anger, mad, hurt, whatever. Boil that down somehow before we went to sleep. Boil it down to, this is a misunderstanding and we're going to get but we're not mad anymore. We're upset or we're confused or we're whatever, but we're not mad. Because sleeping on mad doesn't make it go away. It doesn't. It's amazing what a good night's sleep will do. As you know, Lord Shakespeare said, sleep, perchance to dream, sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care. the death to each day's life, great nature's second course, the balm for hurt souls. Sleep is important. Sleep won't fix mad. It won't. So we agreed to make it right. And sometime after that, I mean, that was back when we lived here, after we'd moved to Nashville, I remembered that and I said, I want to put that in a song about, you know, what we're doing. So statues without hearts, stones with no feeling, playing out a part, never feeling what we say. Statues without heart, stones with no feeling, that's what we'll become if we let love get away. You tell me it's easy to love me. Well, it's easy for me to love you. Oh, but sometimes love that's easily taken is easily taken for granted too. So I'm gonna love you and take care of you, 'cause you're my one and only one. I'll do everything that's in my power to see that we never become statues without heart, stones with no feeling, playing out a part, never feeling what we say. Statues without heart, stones with no feeling, that's what we'll become if we let love get away. We ain't gonna let love get away.
And happy anniversary again.
Huh?
Happy anniversary.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, 50. It's unbelievable. Unbelievable.
And Janice, God bless your soul.
Oh, yes. Yes, good woman. Great, great wife, mother, lover, friend, great grandmother, partner. You know, I as they say in football, I outkicked my coverage.
Yeah.
There we go.
Well, Larry, I told these folks that during the show I was going to have my little Porter Wagoner moments. You know, we couldn't have made 15 years of this in 280-some-odd shows without the help of our corporate sponsors. And I want to thank Chicago Title of Houston. They are, they've been a sponsor with us for a couple of years. Yeah, absolutely. And they sponsor our video podcasts and our syndicated radio show, as well as the live show here. Then my new
Can they help me get a loan?
Can Chicago Title, yes.
They
can make
okay.
sure that you have the title to your house. They can do that for you. Do you already have a title to your house? I mean, that.
Well, having title to your house does not mean that the FBI won't come raid the son of a bitch.
Our podcast just became clickbait, ladies and gentlemen. That's perfect. And now on to my next sponsors. Caldwell Communities. We've got some folks here that work really hard to help make their newest neighborhood called the Highlands, just south of here in Spring, one of the best places to live. So thank you guys for being here. And there's a couple of brochures. If you're looking for a place to live in this area, you need to check out Caldwell Communities. They are like go to the nth degree to plan their communities, and make sure and check out the Highlands in Chambers Creek. And then I told you I recently sold my house, and I don't know about you guys if you've had your finger on the pulse of this real estate market, but it's been just crazy. I mean,
oh, Lord.
The ups and downs, I mean, and as high as it was and what's going on right now, Man, if you need somebody to help you navigate, you know, what your home's worth, should you buy, should you sell, I always say do business with people in the community that support the things you love. And the Griffin Realty Group has been working with us for the last few years. Not only selling homes in this community, but putting their money back into the community by supporting things like Real Life Real Music. So, Griffin Realty Group, y'all wave your hands real quick. If you need to talk to Joel and Christy, go talk to them. But thank you guys for everything you do. I got Steve Saeed, the owner of Do-Si-Do back here. Steve, you've given us a home. You've given us a home for 15 years. It's
Brother
not
Stevie.
Wasted on us. Thank you so
My man.
Much.
Well, may I add, not add to it. I don't mean that. You said... I appreciate y'all too, the sponsors. And you know, in the good book it says, without where there is no vision, the people perish. So to have the vision to do songs and songwriters, it's, thank you. Thank you for sponsoring the show about songs. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. And to you nice friends and neighbors, I have recommitted myself to taking time to let you friends and neighbors know how important you are to me, to my brothers, to our career. Yeah, we got nice houses. Thank you. But it's not just, I swear, it's not just about that. Let me tell you something. I hate air quotes, but we had to go to sing at the Grand Ole Opry about a year and a half ago to an empty Grand Ole Opry house. Because of the pandemic. It was one of the worst experiences of my life as a musician. It was, well, good evening. What do we do now? Folks, we feel, you get it? We feel your energy. It's why they have cheerleaders on football teams and why when the crowd gets going and you play, dig down, you are part of this. You really are. We do love you and appreciate you. We're honored that you like the songs and that, I mean that, you're part of it. You're part of it. Thank you. Singing to that empty house. I'm going to tell you one more story and I'll quit. And I might not. I don't know. Have we sung All the Gold? We did.
Okay,
we'll do that in a minute.
I just wish you were someone I love.
Well, it's impossible to sing all the incredible songs I've written.
Somebody bring me a drink.
And by the way, I'm proud of my humility. Is that possible? The good book says, God forbid that I glory. As a Christian, I'm not preaching to any of y'all, but here's the thing. God forbid that I glory except for the cross of Jesus Christ. I will not, you give God the glory, I can take the credit. All that means is they roll credits at the end of the movie. That says, if you liked it, that guy wrote it. If you don't like it, that guy wrote it. I'm trying to make a point. My wife was standing at the punch bowl at a funeral in Oklahoma. There's always a punch bowl in funerals in Oklahoma and Texas. She was at the punch bowl and a lady came over and said, did I hear somebody say your name was Gatlin? She said, yes. I said, are you married? She said, yes, I'm Larry's wife. I said, we thought so. I said, there's a gentleman over here who would like to talk to you. Do you have time? She said, why, sure. She went over there and sat down because he was really shy and he said, may I tell you a story? She said, sure. He said, 30 years ago, I worked for John Deere Tractor Company, and they sent me to Bulgaria when it was still behind the Iron Curtain. It was still a communist country, and to teach them how to run John Deere tractors and fix them. They sent me over there, and he said, I was sitting on a park bench in Sofia, Bulgaria, the capital of Bulgaria, reading a book, and said, one of the local men came up and said, oh, sir, where did you get that book? They don't let us have books. He said, well, I'm an American. I brought it with me. He said, when you're finished with it, could I read it? I'll guard it with my life. I promise you I will. They don't let it. He said, well, you can have it right now. And he gave that Bulgarian man the book he was reading. And the American from John Deere said, but tell me, sir, where did you learn to speak and read English? He said, I learned to read English and speak English listening to Gatlin Brothers albums they smuggled into the country and on Radio Free Europe. Y'all are part of that. Do you get that? Y'all are part of that. I mean it. If y'all hadn't bought albums, if you hadn't come to concerts, if radio stations hadn't played it, they nobody would have heard it. Nobody would have smuggled it. Y'all are part of that. I mean it. And we, on behalf of Steve and Rudy and our family, we thank you for your part in that, okay? Mm-hmm. Give yourselves a hand. I'm serious. The glory goes to God for being used. So, songwriters matter. And the people who sponsor songwriting shows matter. Okay. And let's talk about that refi rate before I get out of here, okay?
Larry, I think, have y'all had a good time tonight? Okay. I think we've probably got time for a couple more, Larry. A couple more songs.
Okay. One. All the gold. Come on. In California. Is in a bank in the middle of Beverly Hills. In somebody else's name. Say if you're dreaming. Thank y'all for letting me come. I tell you what, I want, if you have time for one more song.
We do. And Larry, I just want to tell you on behalf of everybody here, Do-si-do, thank you for coming and doing this show again. We love having you here.
I enjoyed being here. Thank you. It's always good.
And Hadley Joe, she's over here. Hadley Joe is over here selling. She got some merchandise over here. Y'all support a brand new songwriter that's just getting started.
She's
over and tell her what you thought of the show and pick up a shirt or a hat or something.
She is wonderful. Good, great luck to you, young lady. God's blessings on you. Like you can tell, I have no internal dialogue. And a couple of years ago, the brothers and I were going to go to. We were leaving the country. We were going to California. I don't care if they like it or not. Actually, we were going to Canada also, and we had some. Janice and I had some new people who were taking care of the money for us, and they did not want me to use my American Express. If you miss, it was like 30.84% on the unpaid balance if you miss a month. I mean, it's ridiculous. And so they didn't want me to. They wanted me just to pay cash and bring them a receipt. Well, we were going to be gone 10 days. We don't do that very much anymore. We go 2 or 3 days, we go home. So 10 days is a long time for us on the road anymore. Well, I said, okay, you're going to spend $100 a day. So I said, bring me $1,000. Well, it's a big old wad of money, you know, and I put it, shoved it in my pocket. And my internal dialogue, which, like I say, I don't have, it went external. And I said, Larry Wayne, out loud, I said, Larry Wayne, you got more money in your pocket than your daddy ever had in the bank. And I wrote, mostly fair winds have blown on me. and filled my sails as full as they could safely be. Mostly fair winds have blown on me. I got more money in my pocket than my daddy ever had the bank. I don't know if there's someone to blame, but I do know there is one to thank. I've had my share of ups and downs, and sailed some stormy seas, but mostly fair winds have blown on me. Mostly fair winds have blown on me. Winds of goodness, grace and mercy, and filled my sails as full as they could safely be. Mostly fair winds have blown on me. So forgive me, Lord, if I start complaining that the sun's too hot, the wind's too cold, or that it's raining. As any man could ever be, 'cause mostly fair winds have blown on me. Sing it with me. Mostly fair winds have blown. Winds of goodness, grace, and mercy. Grace and mercy. Fill my sails as full as they could safely be. Fill my sails as full as they could safely be. Mostly fair winds have blown on me. Mostly fair winds have blown on me. And for the last 67 years, you and millions of folks around the world have been fair winds blowing on the Gatlin brothers. We appreciate it. God bless you. May fair winds blow on all of you. Good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Larry Gatlin. Miss Hadley Joe. Hadley Joe Pritchard right over there.